Hello and welcome back to the Embedded World 2023. And thanks for stopping by at the Exhibitors Forum here in Hall 3. Our next topic today is ST Microelectronics, how Stellar microcontrollers boost electrical vehicles performance. And our speaker today is Francesco Petruzzelli from ST Microelectronics. Enjoy.
Good morning, everybody. If you are working in the automotive electrification area, or if you are simply interested in brainstorming with ST on how this journey is evolving, combining electrification and the other mega trends, then you are in the right room today. So as introduced, my name is Francesco Petruzzelli. I'm with ST Microelectronics, responsible for regional marketing, automotive, microcontrollers and processors. And what today I would like to introduce you is how ST is innovating in the digital world to address the challenges and the opportunities of the electrification application in automotive. Because electrification, compared to the other megatrends, is real. So we have cars running on the road, driving on the road since years. But we are at the beginning. So we are just starting, and there is much more to come. So what I want to discuss with you is what we believe the combination of multiple megatrends, software-defined vehicle and electrification, can in the future change the user experience and the capabilities of electrical vehicles for the users and for the industry. So I will not be long. I will try to keep it short and to leave a space for question and answers. So let's see how long I will be able to, I will need to pass the message. So I start a little bit from far away. So software-defined systems, what does it mean? And then as introduction to the software-defined vehicle. So software-defined vehicle can simply mean that you have the possibility to define your car using software. But in reality, a system that is software designed is a system where the abstraction and the control of the functionality is done in software. So this is a very basic, simple definition. That means, let's assume you have a puzzle here that is a square puzzle. If it is hardware, it stays like this until end of life. So you can change this picture. While if it's software defined, you have the possibility during the lifetime of this square, of this object, to adjust it and to make becoming different animals. So we have here, for example, a kangaroo. We have other shapes. And this is what you can do in the field. So afterwards, after the system has been born, has been designed. And then why software-defined vehicle is introduced? And because this is very important to understand the implications on software-defined vehicle, because the two things might look a little bit disconnected, but it is not. So software-defined vehicle is a new megatrend because this enables for the car a second life. So basically, you buy an object at the beginning, like a mobile phone, and at the end of the life, it looks different from how it was when you bought it. And this is one of the most important aspects of software-defined vehicle. In that way, it increases your user experience. It enhances your user experience. So you have also the possibility to enjoy different features over the lifetime. And last but not least, but this is more than for the producers of car than for the user, it enables recurring profit. And enabling recurring profit is not trivial because the business model of the industry is changing completely. So also in the past, who was selling mobile phone were making revenue on hardware selling. Nowadays, it's not like this. It's more software than hardware. And this is happening also for the car makers. So some German OEMs last year had $1 billion of revenue only on software updates. $1 billion of revenue. And this is going to increase in the last 10 years to become double-digit revenues for the OEMs. So, but what does it mean then in terms of electrification functionality, the possibility to update the vehicle and to update the user interface of the vehicle? So in this picture, I'm trying to represent what could be updated over a lifetime of the car. So on the upper part, you have more capabilities that are related to the user experience. That means you can buy more horsepower to have more performances, or you can subscribe to new membership in the infotainment world. And this is, I think, clear to everybody. On the bottom part of this slide, I represent something that is a little bit transparent for the user, but still important, but that it is even more important for the car producers. So the industry can benefit from firmware update over the air because you can enhance safety and security when the car is in the field. So what is this norm here, the R155, that is very popular nowadays in the automotive? It does not only prescribe that you need to fix security threat, but first of all, it forces the OEM to block security threat. So even if you don't have a fix, for example, for a Bluetooth connection, the first thing you need to do is to disable the Bluetooth to prevent that somebody is attacking the vehicle. How can you do this without firmware update over the air, without the capabilities to remotely control the functionality? It's not possible. And this is one example. But the other example that is relevant for electrification is this one, data analysis and maintenance. So the car, being connected to the cloud, has the possibility to learn day by day from the use case, from the user scenario of the users itself. And in this context, this is also another way to represent the famous digital twin concept. So we have on the bottom part the real world, reality. You have the physical car that is around. And on the upper part of this slide, you have the metaverse, where there is a replica of your car in the cloud. And the idea here is that data from the car are connected, are compressed, are pre-analyzed if needed, are sent to the cloud. In the cloud, there is a learning algorithm that is understanding if the user drives more in the city or more on the highway, if it's living in a warm place or in a cold place, if he likes to have a sport drive style or more an economical drive style. And depending on this, can tune the drivetrain, the battery management system, in order to offer to the user better drive experience or a longer drive experience, depending on the specific usage scenario. Once this is done, the updated tuning of the car can be redeployed in the field and goes then in the real car, in the real vehicle. So in this concept, electrification is just at the beginning, because this is still simply started now. And software-defined vehicle does not simply mean that you can update the software of the car, but means also this, means that you can calibrate, that you can fine-tune the functionality of the car in the field day by day. So that is to introduce electrification in terms of opportunities, because, this is meanwhile also by law expected to happen, will happen. And what are the opportunities? Decarbonization is in first place. So the objective, final objective, is to be able to reduce the emission and to have a cleaner environment. But alone, this is not only what we want really to achieve. There is also other opportunities, like, for example, more fun to drive. Because the kind of driving experience that you have when driving an electrical motor is not the same like a combustion engine. And in some cases, we can also combine, because we can have a hybrid car where you have both benefits, the benefits of an electric vehicle and the benefits of a combustion engine car. Last but not least, electrification enables also new opportunities to recycle materials, because we always think that the batteries of a car are somehow not so environment-friendly equipment. But in reality, it depends on how the battery in the car will be reused at end of life of the car. So when they are a little bit worn out, it's still possible to reuse them in other infrastructure, for example, in the grid infrastructure. All this is what is possible with the transition to electrification. But together, because as usual, there are never only pros, there are also some cons in every transformation. Range anxiety. So whoever has an electric car or an hybrid car knows very well how it is after the 300 or 400 kilometers, when the indicators start to say that there is only 10% of the range capabilities left, and then you need to find a way to recharge your car or to fill again the tank that is usually smaller. Charging time, because when you have an hybrid car and you simply can fill the tank in the last few minutes, when you have a full electric vehicle and you need to wait multiple minutes or even hours to recharge the battery. This is, of course, not extremely convenient for the users, for us as drivers. And last but not least is a matter of maturity of the technology. So we said we have done a lot until today, but much more has to be done. And if there is not the possibility to upgrade the functionality of the system so that it stays state of the art also after the car is bought, it is a little bit limiting the capabilities and the functionalities of the electrical system. And in this context, how ST wants to help the industry and support the innovation. So with the full family of products, you see on the left side of this slide the typical three-level representation of a car vehicle. So we start on the top from the cloud services, what I mentioned, the digital twin. Then we go in the middle where there is more the control part, the software-defined part. There is the intelligence, the vehicle computer. And then there are the zones to represent firewalling, a sort of gateway between the software functionality and the harness. And then below there are the actuations with the harness. We play SST a role everywhere. So from the actuation, Stellar E, where E stays for electrification, going up to vehicle computers to zone control with Stellar G and Stellar P. Stellar G and P are called integration MCUs because they allows also the capabilities to integrate more functionalities together. And in particular, Stellar P is designed for motion control. So focus for electrification are Stellar P as integration motion control and Stellar E as actuation with advanced analog capabilities. Only as a brief explanation about Stellar. Stellar is a brand of ST that covers all the automotive 32-bit digital products. So from very low end going up to big SoCs, everything is called Stellar, and then depends on the different series to understand where these products are positioned. So now something that it's very, very schematic, high level. I mean, it does not represent something that is applicable everywhere, but it's a sample representation of how it could look like the electrical drivetrain and power distribution in a vehicle. So on the far left side, you see the grid. This is not automotive. This is the infrastructure. And in this case, we have the alternate current domain, but could be also in terms of charging, could be also a DC charging. So as I said, it's only representation, does not want to be an exhaustive picture. And then when there is the first dotted line, we go inside the vehicle. So the onboard charger is onboard, is an automotive system. And what it does, it generates the DC current to charge the battery pack that is in the middle. Battery pack that can be nowadays 400, 800 volts, and that is strictly connected to a battery management system that is an extremely important electronic control for safety of the car itself, not only for the control of the battery. And then to the battery pack that is high voltage, there is the high voltage power distribution connected. First of all, traction inverter that gives the power, the horsepower to the vehicle, and potentially also a gear shift if, for example, it's an electric vehicle. With the secondary DC-DC, we are transforming this high voltage to low voltage, and then we go to the other consumers in the vehicles. That can be body actuators, can be infotainment, can be chassis actuators. So, very high level, where we as ST are offering a solution with the Stellar P and Stellar E products, mainly in the onboard charger, DC-DC, battery management system, traction inverter, and shift gear. What is the best product to fit? For a simple application, actuation, Stellar E is exactly designed for this. If you want to integrate more functionality in the same system, you may need more horsepower, and then you may go up to the Stellar P MCU. Or you can combine the two things. So you could have Stellar E combined with a Stellar P. But when we are talking about the single ECUs, if you have something that is also trendy nowadays at OEMs, combination of multiple ECUs, then for combos, you could have, for example, onboard charger, secondary DC-DC, battery management system, traction inverter, and gear shift. In that case, most probably you will need a Stellar P. Integration MCU, and you might have for actuation also the need to have a Stellar E. That described in that way are a little bit too abstract. So let's try to explain a little bit better why these products fit the application. And we start with the Stellar E for electrification. So it's a safe and secure digital signal controller for fast control loop. Today, you have on the market a lot of fast control loop controller, which are not automotive grade or are automotive grade, but qualified after life, and that don't offer ASIL safety level, don't offer automotive security, don't offer AUTOSAR support, don't offer hardware support for firmware update. And firmware update over the air support is the basis for software-defined vehicles. So if you don't have this, you cannot do when the car is driving these things that I explained at the beginning. So with Stellar E, we have mathematical accelerators and a sub-nanosecond PWM to implement fast control loop with very fast analog to digital converter with very low latency comparators. And we have as well the mathematical accelerator for Cordic, for example, or hardware resolver. But at the same time, we have, thanks to the Cortex-M7 that is the core of this, the heart of this system, offer also the standard control capabilities like a normal MCU. So basically, you can combine in a single chip both the fast control loop part and the typical housekeeping and control algorithm part of the system. And everything born since the beginning at design level to be automotive grade, meaning with all the ECC protection, end-to-end ECC, and so on, so up to the highest grade of safety. While what is the Stellar P MCU? Because we mentioned both. Stellar P then enters into the game when the performances needed are higher. In that case, we have Cortex-R52 Plus cores. And when there is the need to integrate multi-ASIL virtual machines. So that means we have the possibility to virtualize in real time different virtual machines, thanks to multiple techniques, starting from the core. The core itself, the R52, supports natively virtualization, but also with the design of the platform itself that has been done to allow those kind of advanced features. But there is also much more. So we have high-end accelerators to do the actuation. For example, the latest version of the GTM with high resolution timers. We have mathematical accelerators, fast ADCs. And in particular in this family, but also in the Stellar E family, we have the advanced OTA support X2. Last year, I did a speech on the over-the-air capabilities of this family. So I hope should be still retrievable in the internet. Otherwise, on YouTube, for sure, there is an explanation about how it works, this innovative technique for firmware update over the air. So only one example, because I don't want to bore people here explaining how every topology could look like. But in that case, I am simply representing on the upper part of this slide a standard approach about how to do a DC-DC converter and OBC. So you have a control MCU, and the MCU usually has safety, security, supports AUTOSAR, because this is connected to the rest of the vehicle network. And then you have one or more DSPs that are doing the control loop, that don't have very reduced safety, that have no security, that do not support AUTOSAR, do not support firmware update over the air. So you have at least two, if not four, components to do this kind of control algorithm. When you move to Stellar E on the bottom, you can combine all those things in one single product, and have the possibility to do control and actuation, ASIL-D with security, with firmware update over the air, and we support for AUTOSAR. Everything we want, tool chain, everything born since the beginning, automotive grade. And we are offering hardware because ST is, I think, a well-known supplier of semiconductor components. But this has to be complemented also with software. And in our case here, we are demonstrating at our booth. If you are interested, please pass by. 4A148 is our booth. We have worked with a partner that is a startup called Oxidos, very clever guys that are using Rust, new trendy programming language, which is by default type safe, memory safe, thread safe, and so on. And they developed an operating system, which is called Oxidos, And that is able to work like a small type 2 hypervisor. So basically it runs on the hardware and it offers some sandboxed task where you can run a C application, because if you have legacy C code, you might want to reuse it. But you can also run the applications natively written in Rust and using then all the benefits of this new language, programming language. So in that way, basically you start having a compile time, a good coverage of the ISO standards, plus you have C-like execution speed, and you have also object-oriented like programmer's model. So it is a quick start, a quick way to start in the design of a secure and safe ECUs using safe and secure hardware and safe and secure operating system. This is only, of course, one example. Our ecosystem is much broader, but this is what we are showing here. And then I come to the end, so that there are also some minutes for Q&A, if any. What are the takeaways of this introduction today? So electrification is something of one of the most important megatrends in automotive, together with software-defined vehicle. The two, software-defined vehicle and electrification, are not necessarily decoupled as it could be, as it could look like at the beginning. There are a lot of challenges that have to be solved in the transition to electric vehicles, including the to bring the technology to become much more efficient, and then simplification of the architecture and achieve the highest power efficiency that can be achievable. In this kind of transition, the digital twins and the software-defined vehicle functionalities can help car makers and the tier one producers to achieve this kind of goals, not only at the beginning when the car is produced, but also over lifetime of the vehicle. And then, last but not least, ST Microelectronics, that is providing the components, we don't provide the complete solution, is bringing the technology and the innovation that is simplifying the solution of these challenges. And so we have spoken about Stellar EMCU for actuation electrification, and Stellar PMCU, integration MCU for motion control. That is basically everything I wanted to tell you today. So if you want to know more about our technology, please pass by our hall, our booth in Hall 4A, stand 148. And now I think I can close the presentation and I can leave the stage to you in case there are questions, if any. Microphone in the middle so that the people that are not on site can also hear your question. Would be appreciated.
From Huawei Munich. So I have a question regarding, you know, the recent announcement from Tesla that in the next generation of their product, all the MCUs will be designed in-house. So just wondering, what is your view on this? Thanks.
Well, I cannot comment on this specific announcement, but you may know that this is becoming pretty much popular nowadays, that OEMs are going directly to the Tier 2 to design together the semiconductor products. When they say that they will design by their own, you should not imagine that they will simply produce the semiconductor themselves. So they will be involved and will work in the design of some specific products together with Tier 2. This is what we are seeing as well. We are partnering with many OEMs, specifically this one, I don't think, but I don't know simply, I cannot comment. But with others, yes, there are also press releases around. So it's a trend that is happening, and we will see how far they will go. So because at a certain point, you also need to benefit from the economy of scale. So if you design the products only for your own, it's difficult to benefit from the big volumes. So there must be, at a certain point, a compromise, and then OEMs might design the chips that are making them differentiate from their competitors. Any other question? We still have 6 minutes.
Hello? Okay. So we understood that the importance of the software is increasing, right? So from ST point of view, is going to be an increased offering from software perspective, or because it's becoming more a trend that, you know, even from semiconductor point of view, the offering from software is going up. So what is the positioning of Testy in this from the Stellar family? Is going to be this still mat positioned on the hardware offering? We understood there is already a software offering in the picture, but yeah, if you can comment on this, thanks.
Thank you, a very good question. I mean, this is something that I don't think there is the right answer. What we think we need to do is to invest more in software, but this does not mean that we need to design the software by our own. So mainstream, what ST tends to do is to work more with partners and to enable and to broaden and enable more ecosystem partners than before. But still, software is defining the functionality and remains then the key competence of our customers. So if we provide software to the market, then this becomes same for everybody, means become no longer a differentiator for our customers. So we tend to invest more on what is not differentiating, low-level drivers, safety support, some security support, all the basic functionalities. But we believe that at a certain point, differentiating software like also the algorithm for traction control or for conversion, this has to be left to the customers, to the OEM themselves, so that can differentiate. So it's true that we also invest more in software than before, but still we invest only on what is not differentiated for our customers. Otherwise, we try to simply broaden and sustain and enable the ecosystem, like with Oxidos.
Hi, I have a question. Regarding the definition about your product family, including for this Stellar PGE, so what is the criteria for you to define this difference? Is because of the performance, or you will do some system level testing or validation for different product families, which can support the customers? Is the question. Yeah.
So if I understand the question, you say what is differentiated the different families,
yeah,
P,
yeah.
G, and E.
Yeah.
It's the design, the configuration of the chip. So the backbone, the technology, in many cases is the same. In some cases, we share even the architecture, but then the peripheral mix and the specific features of the different components enable for different applications better than others. At the end, they are all microcontrollers, somehow general purpose, but in a Stellar E, you have picosecond PWM you do not need in body. And in body, you may need more memory for protocol handling than what you need in electrification. So those are examples. Or you may need a Sigma Delta ADC, but you don't need a Sigma Delta ADC in a lighting control. So the peripheral mix and the configuration of the products are making them suitable for a certain application more than another application.
Sorry, just another follow-up question as well. Does it mean that you will also do this product qualification according to different application as well in automotive? For example, your Stellar E, I forgot exactly the brand, is used for BMS, used for DC-DC. So you will make your product qualification also done in the system level for the BMS?
Usually, we don't do system-level qualification, mm-hmm. but we do qualification that is tailored to the application. So, for example, if you are doing combustion engine control, you need a different grade of environmental condition than if you are doing lighting control. This is what we do.
Okay.
We qualify differently the different products depending on the target application, but we usually don't qualify in system. This is responsibility of our customers.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So I'm very happy because I received three questions. This is not normal. I mean, or at least in the last sessions, I have not seen so many questions. That means the topic was interesting. I mean, thank you very much for your time, for the participation. As I said, we are all the 3 days at our booth. So please come and visit us. We have also very good coffee. So thank you very much. Enjoy the show. Have a nice day. Bye.
Thank you, Francesco. And in a few minutes, we have an expert panel coming up. So we continue.